This box from AliExpress is very exciting because in it is one of Nvidia's new AI Raspberry Pis. Is that a reasonable way to describe this thing? And in today's video, I'm gonna do some pre-graphics card gentrification activity on it. Oh, it's ARM-based, so this is gonna be a nightmare to game on, isn't it? That's exciting. That's cool packaging. And it comes with a tiny little 45-watt power brick. It's pretty cute. Oh, that's really cool. We've got a little daughter board that's sitting in what looks a little bit like a laptop RAM slot, but I'm assuming that is where our brain lives of this system. That does mean that you should be able to, at some point, swap this little module out and upgrade it to something faster. Other than that, in terms of I/O, there's a useful amount going on here. I'm hoping this isn't USB 2, though. It probably isn't, despite being the of USB 2. It also has a little Wi-Fi card on the base with two M.2 slots on the back. We've got like a long one and a short one. I'm pretty sure that's their technical name. This little system is called the Jetson Orin Nano, and according to Nvidia, it's its most affordable generative AI supercomputer. But basically, it's an ARM CPU with a whole bunch of Nvidia Ampere GPU cores strapped to it to give you as much GPU processing horsepower as is possible in this small form factor. Now, as is very in vogue at the moment, Nvidia markets this thing as like a generative AI supercomputer, but I think its other use cases like robotics is a lot more interesting than just using it to locally generate slop. The whole object recognition use case for it's also pretty cool. It's even got two little connectors for external cameras that it can use for its processing. Nvidia actually has a whole webpage dedicated to a bunch of community uses of it. If you're interested, I'd go check it out. There's a bunch of cool stuff that people do with these things. But today, I'm probably gonna do the least practical thing with it possible, which is install Windows 11 on it, a process I'm hoping will be fine. It's ARM-based, and Windows's ARM support is reasonable these days, but we'll see how it goes, because I want to try and game on this little PC, which again, it should be able to do pretty well, considering that it has quite a lot of GPU horsepower. But with that, let's jump into the future to do a quick teardown so that we can get some mini supercomputer nudes. Undo that connector. And then I think we have two screws to undo, and then we're good. Let's see. Oh, that was kind of traumatic. But so this is what the base of the motherboard looks like. Here are a bunch of pins that you can short for various system functions, like resetting it and stuff. And this is our little connector. This is such a cute little module. It just looks like a RAM stick with a heatsink on it. On the bottom, we have an SD card slot, which is actually what you use for the operating system, which I don't think is a very good implementation. We'll see what the problems are with this, but let's remove this heatsink and have a look at the chip. And then we should be able to just pop that off. Whoa, it is huge. That's the size of like an RTX 5070 die. It's quite chunky. I mean, it does also have a CPU in there, so it does make sense. Next to that, on either side are our RAM modules. I'm guessing these are two 4 gig modules, considering that it's like an 8 gig system. And below that is the power delivery, which you can actually see on the back as well. I think there's some elements of power delivery here as well. Next, I just did a quick clean so that we could have a look at the die name.
TE960MA1.
Catchy. But with that, let's go back into the past and watch in horror as I suffer to get some gaming happening on this little thing. Now, the first thing I want to do is drop some storage in here. I mean, it's going to be really straightforward. We just flip this bad boy over. Biggest Linus screwdriver one, and it fits perfectly. This M.2 drive already has a copy of Windows on, but I doubt it'll work. I'll explain why in a second, but let's just give it a try. Oh, I don't like how not flush that sits. Now, initially, we're gonna have a bit of a retro Dawid vibe here. I'm just gonna film the screen because the little Nano has a DisplayPort out on it, and that doesn't gel with my capture card. So I don't really know how to turn it on. So I'm just gonna plug it in and hope that works. Okay, yeah, I think it's turning on. Things are spinning, there's a little LED on. Oh, look at that. Oh, F11. Okay, so this is how we select boot devices. Let's have a look at the BIOS. Device manager, I guess? Okay, here we go, RAM disk configuration. Okay, TI's authorization configuration. Yeah, that's all very reasonable stuff that I understand perfectly. So with that, let's see if we can just boot off the... No.
I then tried UEFI shell, which initially asked for some network connection, and then it dumped me in this very intimidating screen, which didn't do anything for ages. I then restarted the little board where it just did the same thing. I ended up stuck on this screen. But it makes sense that it didn't work because it was trying to boot off of a normal Windows install on the NVMe drive which I had in the little system. And the system is ARM-based, so it's obviously not gonna work. So I went onto Microsoft's website and downloaded a Windows 11 ARM ISO, made an install using Rufus, and then tried again.
Okay, so we have our new Windows install in here. We wanted F11, right? ASRock USB.
Which hit me with this very concerning looking warning.
Synchronous exemption. Not sure what that means, but it's gone past it. That's good.
It wasn't good. The system just restarted and then did the whole thing again, dropping me into a loop of synchronous exemption, reboot, synchronous exemption, etc.
And it was at this point where I started to realize that this whole process might be a little bit above my pay grade. I mean, I stuck the thing in the hole and turned it on. What more does it want from me? But apparently that's not giving enough of myself to it. So I decided to next Google what a BI initialized library failure was, which could be caused by a bunch of potential issues, but the solution to most of these was to reinstall Windows, which wasn't really applicable to my situation because I haven't installed it yet. But I did also find a thread on Reddit where someone said they fixed this issue on their system by just changing the boot mode in the BIOS. So I headed into the little Jetson's BIOS looking for some kind of setting that relates to boot modes. I couldn't find anything, but I kind of did change some stuff in there, which did not go well. Why isn't it posting anymore? One of the settings I changed in the BIOS just broke the little Orion. It wasn't posting anymore. And I just couldn't get the BIOS to reset. I tried shorting some of the system reset connectors on the board, but there wasn't like a CMOS battery I could replace to just reset the BIOS on the thing. I just couldn't get it working again.
Approximately 10 hours later.
Okay, it is now the next day and I've magically fixed my little Jetson. I'm not gonna walk you through the process of how I did it. I definitely didn't just buy a new one off of Amazon yesterday. How dare you make such a wrong accusation?
And I also decided to actually do some research on how to get an operating system on the Orion. I know, madness. And initially I was just bewildered by Nvidia's explanation. Why are there so many flowcharts? Engineers are animals. But then I stumbled onto a super idiot-friendly explanation of the installation process by Mr. Bowen, thank you very much. And basically, the process involves using a piece of software called Belina Etcher to pre-install the Linux-based operating system file that you download from Nvidia's website on a micro SD card for some godforsaken reason. Why not just install it on a PS2 memory card at this point? I think you can install it on an NVMe drive, but I didn't want to push the limits of my incompetence here. So it's just gonna do it the way Nvidia tells me to. And then comes inexplicably the hardest part of the process, which is actually putting the tiny little SD card into its slot on the Orion. But I guess I've never been great with holes, so this process might not be as hard for you.
Okay, so all we need to do is plug this, definitely not a new one, in. Yes, there we go. Wow, I am really good at fixing stuff. That's awesome. Hey, I am a genius.
Yeah, apparently having very clearly laid out instructions on how to do a thing makes it way easier to do. At which point I just went through a basic Linux setup and we were good to go.
Wow, more Linuxing happening. Ugh, what just happened to our monitor's color temperatures? Everything just went so warm all of a sudden. Gross.
Color temperature shift aside, I was instantly able to find some gaming on Linux.
Oh, we can play Minesweeper while it updates. Wow, we're already gaming. Damn it.
I'm not good at it. Now, the second thing I want to do is go to power mode and go straight to Maxin Super.
And after unlocking the full power potential of the little Orin, I tried to install Steam on it, which did not go well. The first thing I tried was using some basic terminal commands that I found on Google for installing Steam. You first update the repository and then download the installer, but it didn't work. It was crying about there not being a Steam installation candidate. I then went onto the app store that comes on the Orin and just used the Steam EXE there. But that also didn't work because there were apparently some unmet dependencies. I then spent over an hour going through every single terminal installation guide I could find on Google, none of which worked. Which makes complete sense. I was trying to install x86 software on an ARM platform. In other words, I was trying to smash a square peg into a round hole by repeatedly sudo apting at it.
The thing is, you can technically install Steam on the Jetson Orin. There's a very complicated process involving two pieces of software called Box64 and Wine64, which makes magic happen and does Steam on the Orin. And you know this process is serious because the GitHub pages look like they're documenting how to split the atom. I did briefly attempt to get it working. I found a guide and followed it, which unfortunately didn't work. Almost definitely user error, but still, it made me decide to go a different route. I decided to try emulation instead. Luckily, here again, Mr. Bowen comes to the rescue, where he did another video where he does exactly that. He walks through the process of installing Steam on the Orin and even plays some games on it. I would definitely recommend checking out that video if you want to see it after finishing this video.
Now, of course, because it's Linux, installing RPCS3 is a huge pain in the ass. Linux couldn't figure out the container that it was in for some reason. I spent ages sudo apt getting a bunch of stuff. But it turns out I just had to allow executing file as a program, which doesn't even make sense why it's a setting hidden in the thing, but it doesn't matter. We eventually got it going.
Okay, well, all we need to do now is wait for it to finish compiling some PPU. This process might take ages. Who would have known that running an operating system off an SD card makes a system that's so slow that it just leads to artery-shattering frustration? But anyway, whatever. Calm down. We'll game on it soon. This is almost over, thank God.
But it still wasn't done. Because I was using a trilogy pack of Jack and Daxter, it had to recompile every game. But at least it was doing it with the urgency of a thing that was suffering from a brain hemorrhage while drowning. And then when all of the compiling finally finished, I realized that the controller that I was using didn't work with the game. And to configure the controller, I had to quit the game. It just spent an hour compiling. And then it turns out that the 700-year-old Logitech wired controller that I was using also didn't want to play nice with the emulator, so I had to relaunch the game and then just use keyboard controls anyway.
Oh wow, look at them graphics, and we're getting 60 frames per second. Granted, this is technically a PS2 game, so you really hope that it runs it well. We're getting quite a lot of frame rate. I can't imagine it was running at a frame rate like this on the PS2, but it's very inconsistent. It kind of dips. I really want a frame time graph here. Because at this point, you're just gonna have to take my word for it. Yeah, the frame time graph would be doing this a lot. It really doesn't feel great. It's playable though, you know? But it doesn't bode super well for the newer PS3 games because this is kind of running like butt cheeks. Okay, so the DualShock 4 controller connected super easily once it was charged, and it's just working now. Also gonna try Jak and Daxter 3, although I think this is still technically a PS2 game, so I mean, visually it looks very similar to the previous one. Oh, that is running a lot worse already. Oh no.
I then went into the display settings, was surprised to see that it was already running at 720p, but decided to also drop the shader quality to low.
Oh, that hasn't really helped, has it? We're almost immediately back down to 16 frames per second. Obviously, it feels terrible here. Like, this is not a great gaming experience. But maybe it'll run a more demanding game better? I'm not sure. But I feel like that visual effect shouldn't be there. I like that they give you the frame rate to 2 decimal points, because you know that 4.24 frames per second is playable, but 4.02 is garbage.
I am confused. Why is this happening?
I then bravely tried the PS3 version of GTA 5, which didn't work. It spent ages compiling the PPUs, but then it would just crash immediately at the end of it. Finally, I wanted to try installing Windows 11 on it one more time, despite the fact that Nvidia makes it clear there aren't Windows drivers for this thing. But still, I realized I just needed to turn the ACPI on in the BIOS and then it should boot off a USB, which went very well.
Wait, why isn't it posting again? Was that the setting that broke the first one?